they earned that. Kirsten, Emily, can you stand up once more? Because they've been working for months without any complaints, getting everything in order, bringing us all here, bringing all the swag here, organizing everything. And I think we're gonna have an awesome, awesome, awesome week. So once more, please give them a big hand. Thank you. Not a democracy here, but Kirsten wants my phone. Now, why does she want my phone?
No, I don't know. Your phone, my phone.
Oh, she wants her own phone. That makes a lot of sense, Kirsten. But I trust her, so I was prepared to hand over my own phone. It's here, yeah. It's a nice one. Can we swap?
No, sorry.
I want to send it. I'm just very, very glad to be here. I feel very fortunate that we're all here together. It's amazing. My view is amazing. It's amazing to see you all together. And I know that some of you had to overcome huge obstacles to be here. Some of us are still overcoming huge obstacles to be here, such as my co-founder, Dimitri. But most of us are here, and I'm very, very glad to see that. I want to start with the goal of the summit, which is to get to know people outside of work. We'll be working this week. So we heard last time that working together helps to get to know people. People complained that there was too little working time during the summit, which I think was a great problem to have. But we planned more work time this year so you can get to know each other. As a remote-only company, we should be able to coordinate effectively remotely. So don't focus on your work. Focus on getting to know as many people as you can and celebrate together how far we've come and where we are going. Talking about how far we've come, this was our first summit. It was quite exclusive because it was with 14 members and two significant others. So we got that tradition of bringing significant others started early. Then our time during Y Combinator in Mountain View wasn't really a summit, or you could view it as a 3-month long summit. Our first big one was in Amsterdam. It was 9 months after YC, and we got everyone together in a canal house, and I must admit, it barely fit everyone. Our last summit was in Austin in May of 2016. We were 70 people with significant others. So since August of last year, we doubled the size of our team. So we're here with more than 200 people, including more than 50 significant others. And I've made it a tradition, we'll go slower going forward. So, what do all these people do? We have a mission. Our mission is to change all creative work from read-only to read-write so that everyone can contribute. And that is inspired by Git. Git changed software by making contributing to software from something you had to be invited for to something everyone that could get the source could do. And we're now focused on making it easier to collaborate on software, but we'll not stop after that. Right now, many parts of our culture are not open to suggestions. So our goal is to make every book, every movie open to collaboration, because culture evolves much more rapidly if you can stand on the shoulders of what others have done before you. And to realize our mission, we're working in a sequence of 5 steps. We've already done the first thing, become the most popular self-hosted Git solution. And now we're focused on number 2, because we want to become the self-hosted Git solution that generates the most revenue. Because we'll need a lot of people, and a lot of money to finance the rest of our journey. And after we realize that, we'll focus on step three. And that is to have people host their private projects on GitLab.com. So become the most popular SaaS for private projects. And we need the whole world to use that, because in the end, we also want people their public projects on GitLab.com. But there are huge network effects there. So we want to convince them to use GitLab.com for their private projects, find out how good it is, that it is better, and then we can make the world switch. And our big, hairy, audacious goal is to make sure all creative work is made with GitLab. Right now, we as a company have to focus on step two, not get ahead of ourselves. But because GitLab is open source, companies like Penflip and O'Reilly already use GitLab to make collaboration on books easier. And I hope that going forward, many people will use GitLab to create their own solutions for other types of media. So why is it that we have this opportunity to grow so fast? It's because Git is a generational shift in the software collaboration process. Previous generation products find it very, very hard to adapt to Git. So basically, everyone needs to switch to a new product. Right now on the marketplace, that is GitHub, Atlassian, and GitLab. And of those three, we have a huge advantage in being the only integrated product. So GitHub is not an integrated product. It has lots of features that you need other tools for. So you need to amend it with all kinds of other tools. Atlassian has a full suite of products, but they're not integrated. We make sure that customers and users only have to install one package. They only have to upgrade one package. We have one configuration, for example, to integrate with LDAP. We have one convention of what a happy path is. We have one interface, one license that they need to purchase, one data store where you can find all the events, and one code base for both server and .com. So because of that, GitLab allows you to get from idea to production faster. Because of one package, it's easier to install, easier to upgrade. Because it's one configuration, it's easy to set up. Because there's one convention in the way things work, and you don't have to customize it, it makes for faster onboarding. If you switch teams, there's not a completely different workflow. One interface makes for a lot better user experience. And one license makes it easier to purchase. Because we have one data store, we can do complete analytics. We can do cycle analytics that show you how long it took you to get from idea to production. It's very hard to do if you use all kinds of products. And because we have only one code base that we maintain, we can ship at a much faster rate. Our rate of improvement is much faster than the competition. So those benefits are recognized in the marketplace. And we've been able to exceed most of our goals for 2016. We tripled our annual recurring revenue. We were able to fundraise $20 million at great terms in a tough fundraising market. You cannot buy Enterprise Edition per single user. So, and Enterprise Edition products are now available at a premium subscription of $199. And last but certainly not least, we built a complete idea to production lifecycle. So the tripling of revenue, to start with that, that is great that we exceeded that goal, because this helps us to get to IPO in 2020, our goal. And it also means that next year we have to achieve the same thing again in order to stay on that track. We're really thankful for all new customers that believe in us. This is a selection of the 426 customers that we gained in the last quarter. But I think even more important is that existing customers are happy with GitLab. We can see that they are adding a lot of users to their installation. So if you take a group of customers and look at them a year later, you normally see a significant drop in the number and the dollar amount. At GitLab, we see that 98% of our customers are still with us. And I like to believe that that 2% switched to the community edition and are there for me. And they spend 75% more money with us. So this is very important because it shows that as GitLab, we are helping them to get to idea to production faster and that they're happy with the product. So what kind of products do they use? So right now we have 3 products to run GitLab yourself. We have GitLab Community Edition. It's our open source edition. And we want to be a good steward of the open source project. It's very hard to do right. It's a tricky balance, but we've proven again and again we can get it right. And we have our ears open for any time we make a mistake, we correct it. We also use it to lock out competition. We want our open source edition to be better than the paid product of the competition. And we use it to generate demand for our offerings. It's helping us to create awareness for GitLab. Then we have Enterprise Edition Starter. It's $39 per user per year, and it's targeted to markets of teams of more than 100 people in the company. Then we just introduced Enterprise Edition Premium. Its target market is teams of more than 750 people. And then in the future, we might introduce Enterprise Edition Ultimate. Next year, it's going to be $999 per user per year. And it targets organizations with more than 5,000 people. But we're very careful that when we introduce higher priced offerings, we never take features away from the existing offerings. People that use that can expect to get more features every month without paying a cent more. So this is important because introducing higher price points can get us to the 100 million in ARR we need to grow. We need to grow our average revenue per user. So we're an integrated tool. We're replacing multiple paid products for the customer. So large organizations need help from our marketing department, our sales department, our customer success teams to replace those legacy products. By replacing them, we can help them to ship their applications faster. And if we can transform huge organizations into being a software company, they are prepared to pay more per user. So that's the same case, and they all need to become one. If whether they're a car manufacturer now, or whether they're a phone manufacturer, whether they're a bank or a movie studio, software is eating the world. And every company in the world will have to become a software company with GitLab. So apart from our self-hosted products, we have 2 products that we host ourselves. There's GitLab Hosted. It's for users that want a single tenant solution, they want their own private installation, but they don't want the burden of maintaining it. We do the backups, we do the upgrades. We're growing that slowly and steadily. We're gonna focus more to guide users to the Enterprise Edition variant of users, and the Community Edition variant of it will make that a more specialized offering for basically teams that are insisting that all of the software they use is open source. Then we run GitLab.com. And there's a couple of goals with GitLab.com. We want to create awareness for GitLab, so we want a place where you can easily try it out. We want to test our own code and gather data on our own platform because it helps us to iterate faster and prevents us from shipping bugs that affect the installation of our self-hosted customers. And we want to upgrade people that use it to paid GitLab.com subscriptions. And last, but certainly not least, it's an entry point to move people to Enterprise Edition and GitLab Hosted as they grow. So you can export your products and you can export your projects from GitLab.com and import it in a self-hosted installation. So GitLab.com is an important part of our future. Right now, we have a couple of subscriptions plans. So we have the free edition. It comes with limited build minutes, and it's aimed at organizations that have less than 100 users. We have the bronze edition, we're going to change that price to $199 per user per month, and it's going to have more built in it. It's aimed at organizations up to 750 users. Then in the future, we'll likely release two more subscriptions. There will be a $5 per user per month edition that will contain the features of Enterprise Edition Premium. So that's for up to 5,000 users in your organization. And we'll have a Gold subscription. It's going to be $49.99 per user per month. And it's aimed at organizations that run on GitLab.com with more than 5,000 users. Right now, we're focused on saving on hosting costs. So we're looking to partner with one of the major cloud providers and to optimize our use of resources to reduce our hosting bill. We're very much focused on improving the latency. Right now, GitLab.com is too slow. We have different initiatives to change that. One of them is Gitly to make the Git access faster. The other one is probably implementing CitusDB, sharding the database. Git access and the database are the only like choke points for GitLab.com, and if we're able to solve that, we can make the whole installation faster. For more information, you can look at infrastructure issue 947. So we used to be a product company. We ship software, our customers run it. We'll now have to become good at two things, products and services. Offering a service like GitLab.com is a fundamentally different thing. And that's going to be a challenge as we grow our organization to be able to become good at two things. That's not easy. We thought about hosting our own infrastructure, but we're very lucky that we can stay in the cloud. So we don't also have to become good at hosting, because that will be a first thing, and three things are pretty hard to do. So, but it's gonna, you're gonna find that as we go along, there will be changes to the organization to make sure we can offer service and that we offer that effectively and that it's fast. So with GitLab, we wanna ship the whole idea to production lifecycle, and that consists of 10 steps. First, you talk about an idea in chat. We ship with Mattermost, and we also have a great Slack integration for that. And you plan an issue on our issue tracker. You plan that issue with our issue boards. And I think we've done a great job of making sure our issue board is completely integrated with our issue tracker, but it's still easy to use. So we don't need to acquire another company. We can make our issue board better. Then we ship with a web terminal to get quick access to machines and to start coding in an online environment. We have repositories you can commit that code to, and we have a CI and container registry to help with testing. We allow you to review your code. We have merge request discussions, and we have the review apps. The review apps are amazing because anytime you make a proposal, people can quickly test how that feels, how that works. And then we allow you to deploy those things to staging with GitLab Deploy and Auto Deploy, and to get it into production by deploying from chat with ChatOps. And last but certainly not least, we give you feedback. So we ship with Cycle Analytics that will tell you how long it took you to get from idea to production, at what parts you were stuck, and you need to improve that time. And we're going to give feedback with monitoring. So right now, when you're deploying, you really don't know how you affected your metrics. And with Prometheus, we're going to do a much better job there. So in June, during fundraising, we presented shipping this to investors as our goal for 2016. At least three investors said that we couldn't ship the complete idea to production lifecycle this year. They didn't believe us. So I'm very, very proud. We shipped this year, 6 months after announcing it in 8.15. I'm very, very proud of all of us. And I want to mention Camille specifically for going above and beyond to make this happen. Looking back in 10 years, people will think it is very strange that this life cycle used to require so many different tools. before GitLab integrated it. It was not one of our goals. It's not our goal to grow an organization. We'd rather stay small, but we have so many things to do. So what happened during the year is that we also become the largest organization where everyone works from a different location. Not just a different location, from the location they prefer to work from. And that forces us to focus on results instead of hours worked. It forces us to be very disciplined in how we communicate. I am a broken record of, can you write that down? Can you make an issue for that? Can you update the handbook? Do we really need that meeting? It also forces us to organize informal communications. And we have team calls, we have virtual coffee breaks, but what we're also seeing is people traveling the world to visit colleagues. Yesterday, Frauke mentioned a house swap. So I think it's great that informal communication isn't an accident, but it's something we can organize and we can make it a better and a more fun experience. I'm very thankful for all the significant others that organized their lives so they could be here, and I want them to feel very welcome. So please give them a hand. Thank you. Being a remote-only organization has many advantages. We can hire the best people in the world, no matter where they live. And it allows us to be effective by having less disruptions. At GitLab, only this week people are tapping you on the shoulder. It's going to be fun this week, but we're going to be a lot more effective after we get back home, and we can focus on the things that we think are important and that will get results. And last but certainly not least, it's easier to combine work with the rest of your life if you're not stuck to fixed hours. I want everyone to experience the freedom to work the hours that they want to work, and to take days off, afternoons off, to go shopping during the day and everything like that. Another thing that I think went well in 2016 is that we stuck to our values. Our values are results, transparency, efficiency, frugality, collaboration, directness, kindness, diversity, boring solutions, and quirkiness. And I think a great example of our values and sticking with them was our blog post, how we knew it was time to leave the cloud. It was transparent. It was a conversation that normally happens internally, and we put it out there. It was efficient because we got the opinion of hundreds of experts that chimed in with the best knowledge in the world. It was frugal because our input was a day of writing, and we got a huge amount of input. It was a great collaboration. We were responding on the blog post, people were tweeting, people were sending me lots of emails to my private address, as in, I can't comment publicly, but I really want you to know you should use IBM PowerPC architecture. It was, I think, a great example of directness, because being direct to other people is easy. What is hard is to accept that directness. If someone gives you feedback, giving feedback is easy, although it's on the sender to make sure it's structured well, but it's hard to accept that you're wrong. So we were wrong and we changed our opinion. We're not leaving the cloud. And I think we learned from that there was a more boring solution. So I was very excited with the idea of using Ceph. And that wasn't a boring solution. And we figured that out with the help of all the people that commented. And now we're going to do the boring thing and stay in the cloud. Not everything went great in 2016. The most important things, like lots of things went wrong. I make lots of mistakes every day. I hope that everyone makes lots of mistakes every day. Otherwise, you're probably not doing a lot and not taking a lot of decisions. But the biggest problems were we had too few sales opportunities, too few SQLs, and too few new customers. Both were below what we planned for the year. It's great that despite that, we still met our revenue target. But in 2017, we're doing things different to remedy the above points. So we're going to focus our marketing on enterprise adoption of GitLab. We're going to generate more sales opportunities in marketing. We're going to grow the SDR team, what was formerly known as the outbound BDR team. The SDR team is now reporting into sales to make sure that they can collaborate closely with the account executives. We're going to grow a customer success team to help with getting more sales from existing customers by helping them adopt more of the product. And we're going to grow our sales team. Now, with all the changes that are happening, and as the company is growing, it's hard to stay aligned. It's hard to know what are the three things I should do, what are the three things my boss should do, what are the three things my boss's boss should do. So we're introducing something called OKRs. It stands for Objectives and Key Results. Everyone will have about three objectives, and every objective has about three key results. And the idea is that the key results of your manager relate to your own objectives. It's not always a one-on-one mapping, but they should be closely aligned. And that aligns the whole company from top to bottom and from bottom to top. And that also ensures that everyone's three priorities are clear to them and the rest of the organization, even when we grow. So OKRs are not what we expect to do or what we plan to do, it's what we aim to do. So it's ambitious. So we expect to achieve only 70% of the things we put in the OKRs. If you're achieving more than that, either you did really well, you got lucky, or you aim too low. And the thing we don't want to do is aiming too low. And our OKRs will be public. Transparency is one of our values. You can already find the link on our website that show our entire goal tree for the whole company. What will not be public is how you're achieving on those OKRs, because we want performance feedback to be between a boss and a report, not to involve the rest of the company here. So what are the OKRs? So our company goal is with a great team, we want to create a next generation product used by everyone. And I'm going to distill that down. It has three objectives. Want to have a great team, want to build the next generation product, it should be used by everyone. So how do we know we have a great team? There's three elements that I have as my key objectives or key results. We want to be a great company to work for. So we want you to be happy. And the metric we'll use for that is ENPS, Employee Net Promoter Score. We'll ask you, how likely are you to recommend GitLab to a friend? You'll score us. My aim is to make sure that score exceeds 4.5 on a scale of 1 to 5. And I think one of the most important things we can do is to provide you with leadership, because people leave jobs because their boss is bad. So one of the things I'll be focusing on is improving leadership at GitLab. As we grow so fast and we're promoting people fast, we have to do a great job of training those people and backing them up with support. And the second thing is great interviews. I heard how many candidates we have every week, but I couldn't believe the number and I forgot to double check it. Does Sasha or Nadia know how many applicants we have every week or every month? 100 applicants a week.
More than 100.
It's uncountable, I'm hearing. That's a lot of people. And although we grow really fast, we're not growing that fast. So we have to decline the vast, vast, vast majority of people. It's like a single digit percentage, probably low single digits, that actually gets hired. And I've applied to companies, and it's a very stressful process, and it confronts you with yourself. So we should do a great job of following up with those people and making sure that even though they might be rejected, it is a great experience. So I think that process has improved a lot, and that's also due to hopefully the most important part, Sasha and Nadia, who've been doing a great job helping everyone there. And we want to do even better. So we're going to send all those people that got declined an interview, like, how likely are you to recommend applying to GitLab to a friend? These are people that were just declined. So we expect a half point drop in that promoter score. But we're going to strive to be direct in our communication, because one of the most annoying things I've ever found is that no one gives you great feedback on your interview process. Companies don't do that because there's a legal risk for that. We're going to take that legal risk. We're going to strive to do our very best to give them proper feedback that helps them improve themselves. And we should be thinking about all the other ways in which we can help those people to become better, to hook them up with whatever they need to become better. So we're going to be thinking about that. We're going to find out what they think about GitLab, because we can either every week create 100 people that are bummed out about GitLab, or people that are a fan of GitLab will be better and apply again in 2 years. Then the last goal is to have great hires. As we grow, we're getting amazing applicants. And I think you should always try to hire people that are better than yourself. And I think we're doing that, but we want to keep that bar very high. Right now, we're getting better known, so we're getting more applications. So that will allow us to put that bar high and to make sure that we only hire the people that align with our value and that will get the results that are needed and that are in their job description. The second thing is used by everyone, and that has three key results. We want to see revenue growth. I already said we need to grow at least 3 times this year. An OKR should aim higher. So our OKR aim is not to triple, but to quadruple in annual recurring revenue in 2017. The second thing is we want to grow the number of leads. So the draft goal there is to create 1,000 sales opportunities in the first quarter of this year. And last, but certainly not least, we want to grow the awareness for GitLab. Right now, we're number 3. There's GitHub, Bitbucket, and GitLab. And our goal in the first quarter is to overtake Bitbucket in Google Trends. Last objective, be a next generation product. Few things are needed for that. First of all, we gotta make GitLab.com fast and reliable. So 99% of every time someone tries to load a page of GitLab, it should load within a second. And if it's down, we're counting that as not loading within a second. Second thing is, wanna ship awesome features that make people excited about GitLab. So every time we release, we'll try to make it to ship so great features and explain them so well that people will retweet our release tweet more than 250 times. And obviously, it's not just about the tweets, but the tweets are a way to measure how excited people are. And objectives and key results, the key results should be quantifiable. So I'm open to other suggestions, but I think this is a great way to measure. The last thing is to become a cloud-native development tool. And we'll measure that by asking developers to name the cloud-native application development tool. And we hope that more than half of the time, they'll talk of us. So I'll go into cloud-native more on the following slides. But I want to say, why are these our goals? So the first one is because if GitLab.com is slow, people think GitLab is slow. GitLab is not slow. If you run it yourself, it's more than ample fast enough, and our existing customers are really happy with it. But if we give the impression that GitLab is slow, that hurts, that will hurt us for years to come. So we've got to make sure that wherever people try GitLab, it's always fast. And the second thing, we basically went from followers to leaders. We used to play catch up to the competition, and now we're leading. Features we release, such as protected branches, our issue board, our merger press conflict resolution, auto deploy. We are shipping faster than the competition, and the competition, it has to play catch up to us. So, and they are awake now, and they're trying to do that. So there's only one solution. We should keep shipping faster than they can copy us. And the last thing, the cloud native application development tool. I want to go into that because the world is changing. Cloud native means using containers as infrastructure. Infrastructure first used to be bare metal machines. Then it was using virtual machines. And now it's moving to containers. So where it used to be VMware, AWS, Heroku, now things are moving to container schedulers and in specific Kubernetes. So the once in a generation shift to version control with Git gave us an opportunity to build the company as it is today. But now we have a once in a generation opportunity in infrastructure that presents an opportunity to become the dominant player here. It is really, really hard to deploy your app on a container scheduler today. There are about 200,000 developers trying to work with that. They're using containers for development, but using it in production is not easy. So if we can make that easier, we can become the default application development tool for cloud native applications. So GitLab is already doing a lot of things to make container schedulers as simple as using Heroku. We have auto-scaling CI, we got ChatOps, and we got review apps. Those are all in 8.14. We can now auto-deploy any application, whether it's Ruby or Java or Node, and we ship that last month in 8.15. Now we're working on other things, integrate monitoring, deploy boards, feature flags, and we'll need the help of our new Prometheus team to build this. If we are the default for using containers, then people will move to GitLab, ensuring we're used by everyone. The containers today are too hard, and we found that out ourselves. We were working on auto-deploy, and we had a very hard time wrapping our head around auto-deploy and how it should work. And we started building buttons and features and everything. Turned out, in the end, we didn't need anything new in GitLab. We just needed to add a GitLab CI.jaml template called auto-deploy. That was it. Okay, and some of Camille's magic in making a great container. But there was no change to GitLab as an application needed. It is just very hard to get started with, to wrap your head around it, and we got to do that work so people that use GitLab can focus on shipping their application faster. So I want to welcome our new Prometheus team. Ben and Julius, could you please stand up? We have Ben, our new lead. Please say hi to him. In the front was Julius, a team member, and there's two other team members that couldn't attend the summit, Kevin and Brian. So Ben will also present Thursday at 4 p.m., so I encourage you to check out that presentation. And if you want to know more, there's a blog post we recently released. I encourage you to watch that video of Mark presenting about Prometheus in GitLab, and there's an infrastructure issue about all the different monitoring things that are going on. So to make it concrete, what we want to achieve in the first quarter of 2017, I want to present some slideware, a preview of the flow that we want to achieve after the quarter ended. So we want people to go to Google Cloud and create an account, and then start a Kubernetes cluster and install GitLab on it. Why Google Cloud? Because they have something called Google Container Engine, abbreviated as GKE. And that's a great way to host the Kubernetes cluster because they made Kubernetes and they upgraded it for you. So after you install GitLab on it, You create a project, you create an issue, and you click a button called Rally at Rally. And what Rally does, it rallies around the issue. It rallies you around the issue. What happens is a chat channel is created, and all the followers of the issue are invited to that chat channel. It was an idea by John, made during our last summit, and I think it's amazing because you should be able to switch between working with more of a delay in an issue and contemplating things, and then switching to more real-time communication in chat, and then allowing you to switch back, but preserving the history and the logs so that you don't miss out on anything. So you rally around the issue, and you figure out you need to create a new issue. So we create an issue from chat, and it would be nice to include like the last three messages that you talked about. You plan the issue with our issue board. And making the issue board, I think, was an idea by Jo during our last summit, and I'm very pleased to say it cost a lot less than 400 million. Then you create a branch from the issue. So it will show a create branch issue button, even when there is no repo, allows users to select the auto-deployed GitLab CI template and initialize the repo with that. Then you can start a web terminal, make and push a simple Rails app. And we're thinking about the ability to create a merge request right from the web terminal. So you want to make that link that you currently get, make that clickable in the web terminal. You have the merge request, a review app should launch, and you should be able to check that out. And then, if you like what you're seeing, you use ChatOps to deploy it to production, to master. And then you review the monitoring. So we want to show the metrics that most changed in the merge request. This is a hard one because this will require a lot of work. This means we have to ship Prometheus with GitLab, not only to measure GitLab itself, how GitLab is performing, but also to measure all the applications that are deployed with GitLab. Only when you measure those things, you can be sure that the change you made is improving things. So we want to give people feedback on the what changed in the systems, like your CPU load, what changed in the application, like number of errors, but also your business metrics. Are you making more money now that you deployed this? And this is really hard to detect because if you measure the whole application, over time everything changes. So you need kind of a canary deployment where only part of your application servers are running the new version, and compare that with what is happening on the other servers. So we need to ship canary deployments, ship Prometheus with GitLab, tie that all up together so that you can see those metrics right there in the merge request. Because that feedback is essential, what happened after I deployed. Then you can review the cycle analytics, see how long it took you, and see what you can do to make it happen faster the next time. What is the roadblock to get faster from idea to production? So we want to show a demo of 10 minutes where we do what I just showed, because those 200,000 developers are spending a lot of time making all of this work today. And today, if you want to do this and you set it up with tools other than GitLab, you're spending a week of integration making that all happen. So if we can do that in 10 minutes, they have to spend only 1% of that time. We already did it for auto deploy, and I think we can make this happen too. And this will make us a cloud native application development tool and ensure our continued growth. So I have a challenge. If you are the first one to present the idea to production demo working on Google Container Engine on stage during the summit, I will dance the Sid Shuffle from Ice Age 4 out of pure happiness. And thanks, Ted, for reminding me that I have a dance. So, I want to conclude with two things. First, I want to warn you that our road ahead won't be easy. We're a startup, and we'll have our share of setbacks and problems. We have to keep outshipping multi-billion dollar companies. So, it's going to be a bumpy ride. But I think our work and mission is meaningful, and I think that everyone will remember this, what we're doing. And I'm very certain we can achieve what we set out to do. We have an integrated product. We'll make it a cloud-native product. We listen to our users and our customers, and we have the best team in the world. Go GitLab!